that calls for the best out of us. When we see such a situation, then that is calling for the best out of us. What do I mean by that? In the natural, you will say, well, that requires more energy. That requires we work harder. That requires that we labor more. Spiritually, that is not the meaning of requiring the best out of us. Spiritually, the meaning is that the gift of God within you, you work on it until that gift begins to operate at its maximum and at its best. But if you are thinking naturally, you will think that it is the natural strength that you must put to more, But Ecclesiastes chapter 10 verse 10 says very clearly that he must put to more strength, where there is no wisdom, all right? And if you put more strength, then you will get weary and you get tired. And so Ecclesiastes advises us to have wisdom to sharpen the edge so that we will not labor too much. So what to do is to call forth at the gift of God within us so that we will be able to contribute to his kingdom. Number two, it is a situation that allows us to cry out for what grace can conquer. All right? That will be a major focus this evening after we finish the content of the scripture. What can grace conquer? What really can grace conquer? Joshua with the children of Israel, they conquered all these kings. So what can grace conquer in our world? Thirdly, it is a situation that challenges us to ask for power from God. To ask for power from God. And that we don't stop asking for power until the power arrives. Until the power comes. Until the power shows up. Until the power becomes manifest. And people can see it that actually the power indeed has come. And once it comes, you refuse to allow it to go. You refuse to allow it to vanish. I remember a brother about 4 years ago. He was so thirsty. He was so panting after God. And he didn't know what to do. He had been in church and a leader for almost 15 years. And he had cried out for baptism of the Holy Spirit and all that. But he did not receive baptism of the Holy Spirit because he did not know what was involved in order to receive. And so he was searching the whole world for somebody he can align with, somebody he can follow, so that the power of God will make manifest in his life. And he kept on going to the hotels to rent hotel for 3 days. He will fast and pray. He will call upon God. But he was not filled with the Holy Ghost. But eventually, he found my name on the internet. And then he asked if he could see me. Of course, you know these virtual things. Virtual things sometimes are very unreal. Somebody is in Ibadan and is calling you with London number. And somebody is in Ibadan and is calling you with New Zealand number. All kinds of things like that happen on the internet. And so you find out that these are the kind of wickedness that happened today. Praise God. May God defeat your wicked pursuers in the name of Jesus. So, this brother was, and he was filled with the Holy Spirit. But he did not allow the matter to rest there. He took it seriously. At least the things he had heard about me and the things he knew encouraged him to push beyond where he was. And so he went and did more, prayed continually, prayed so much. And today, as I'm talking to you, is a firebrand, real firebrand, because the power has come. So that's what I'm talking about. It's a situation that challenges you and I to ask for power from God. And I've used that illustration to illustrate when you know and when you are seeking, when you know the power has arrived. It is not something that is supposed. When the power comes, you will know the power has come. It is a situation that calls for the best out to battle. Who can believe in God who is a man of war? We can believe in God who is a man of war. It challenges our faith. Like we have just sang now, that our God is an awesome God. how awesome is our God? How fearful is he? How strong is he? How powerful is he? Can we ever compare him with anything that terrorizes man on the surface of the earth? God forbid that we face the terror of God. And that's what the Apostle Paul said. He said, knowing the terror of God, we persuade men. He said, knowing the terror of God, we persuade men. You know, when people are still going around and things look nice to them, oh, they have no problem. But God forbid you fall under the terror of God. It is then you recognize that God is really strong and can make an ordinary fly to kill you. It can make an ordinary ant to kill you. It can make an ordinary worm to kill a man, and he's gone forever. That's how powerful God is. So it is a situation that does not belittle you, but makes you see the standards set by our fathers in the faith. And so we see a man like Joshua, who like a general, who like a missionary, who like a warrior for God, goes into foreign land, goes into the hidden land, and just rampaging the place. But so to say today, that's the thing we say today. So it is a situation that sets up sets us up to conquer our unbelief in the covenant. It is that serious belief in the covenant that pushed Joshua that God will not abandon him. But as God lives, God will show up during the battle. It is a situation that draws tears from our eyes to plead with God for our own generation, because we see a generation that is weak, we see a generation that is worldly, we see a generation that are beggarly, we see a generation that only think about eating and drinking. We see a generation that is degenerate. We see a generation that are not interested in the things of God, but rather they are pulled away by the intricacies of this life. Those were not the power that Joshua had in order to be able to conquer nations and conquer territory. No, it was not the fancifulness of what they were doing in Canaan, or among the Hivites, or among the Jebusites, or among the Canaanites, or among the Perizzites, or among the Amorites. It is not what they were doing that mattered. It was what Jebusites were doing that interested Joshua, not at all. It was what God was doing in his life that became a setup. It became something that became the standard. And so we see that these are the things that we can learn from the book of Joshua chapter 12. And I want to challenge anyone who is listening everywhere that in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that nothing will reduce your life to zero in the name of Jesus. You see, these principalities and powers were overcome under Moses, and we have read them, all right? There are kings conquered by Israel under the leadership of Moses. These are the kings of the land whom the children of Israel defeated, and whose land they possessed on the other side of Jordan toward the rising of the sun, from the river Arnon unto Mount Hermon and all the eastern part of Jordan. All right. So these are the kings of the land whom the children of Israel defeated. The land of this king comprised of Israel's land on the eastern side of Jordan's river and on the other side of Jordan towards the rising of the sun. It's good to emphasize that, because today Israel is still fighting over that land, and they are defining what is their border, and there's been a fight with Israel, with the United Nations and everybody else fighting Israel to try to redefine the configuration of the children of Israel. So these are things that we can learn from what I've been talking about, that when God gives you a portion, you defend your portion, you possess your portion, you pray and possess your portion. And let me say one underlying principle, is that God would never ask you to go and do something that grace cannot conquer. He would never ask you to go and do anything that grace cannot overcome. That's very basic. So what God asked Joshua to do, he was able to get Joshua to have that grace and told him what you need is courage. And I told you before that another word for courage is hope. And hope means tomorrow. Hope means the future. The future is sound. The future is solid. There's nothing going to be wrong in the future. That's hope. It is that hope that makes a person to be bold, because he's looking ahead of himself and he sees the possession. He sees the goal. He sees where he's going. He sees that he will get there. That is hope. Even though he's not there now, but he's here and he has faith that he's going forward. That is what makes a man strong. That's the meaning of courage. It's the same thing with vision. The word vision, the word hope, the word courage, all are parallel in the realm of the spirit. When a person does not have vision, is ready for abuse. Alright? Because the Bible says that without vision, in Proverbs chapter 29, it said the people perish. Alright? Another version says the people dwell carelessly. For instance, if a woman does not know that her womb is supposed to provide to produce prophets that will preach and take nations. Well, of course, if he does not know that that is the purpose of her womb, to give birth to prophets, she will be abused sexually. She will go around harlotting. She will go around doing all manner of evil. All right, because he doesn't know the purpose. He doesn't have a vision of why she was born. He doesn't have a vision why she's here. And as a result, you know, without a vision, the person would dwell carelessly. And so, when you see vision, when you see hope, when you see courage, they all match to you are going to win. You know you are going to overcome. You know that nothing is going to stop you. That was the kind of courage that Moses had. That was the kind of courage that Joshua had. And the defeat of Sihon, the king of the Amorites, and his land for Israel to possess, in verse number 2 and 3, we are told very, very clearly. So one king was Sihon, king of the Amorites, who dwelt in Hezbon and ruled half of Gilead from Aroer, which is on the bank of the river Arnon, from the middle of that river, even unto the far, far east of river Jabbok, which is the border of the Amorites, and on the eastern Jordan plain, from the Sea of the Generals, as far as the Sea of of Araba, that is the Salt Sea. Now, the road to Bethel, Jeshimoth, and southward slopes to Pisgah. Now, which kings have grace and power help you to conquer? What kings and which kings have grace and power help us to conquer? We have to estimate, can this go into the records of heaven, that you conquered this king, that you conquered this land, that you conquered this group of people? Maybe not you alone, but in the company of others, if you can preserve a record that this and this and this happened. Now, that's what gives you a kind of confidence by the grace of God that I was part of the team. I was part of the grace of God that conquered and overcame that, which I'll be talking about that a little bit when we get over this part that sometimes look, like I said before, very, very tedious. Now, number 3, it says the defeat of Og, king of Bashan, and his land that Israel possessed, in verse 4 and 5. Now, the other king was Og, king of Bashan, and his territory, who was of the remnant of the giants, who dwelt at Astaroth and Edrei, and reigned on Mount Hermon and Salcah, even unto Bashan, also as far as the border of the Geshurites and the Maachathites, and over half of Gilead to the border of Sihon, king of Hezbon. Now, I've read all that to tell you one thing, and it is important. And that is to say that the giants were still in the land. Some of them were remnants of the giants. But that did not create a fear in the heart of the children of Israel. They still went ahead to fight. They still went ahead to, you know, to fight it out and take their possession. They were not afraid of this 9-foot-tall, 10-foot-tall group of people who were challenging them and threatening them, you know. But they had to face them in battle, and by the grace of God, they were defeated. I don't know what is your problem. And I don't know what giant you are facing. Sometimes we face the giant of cancer. Sometimes we face the giant of some blood disease. Sometimes we face a giant of some bone problem. Or we face a giant of witches and wizards. Or we face some giants of some evil persons. Or we face some giants of wickedness. And we don't know what to do. But look at Joshua and the rest. They with determination, they went forth, and in the power of God, they were able to defeat every challenger. And that is what it shall be at the end of time. Hallelujah. I said hallelujah. I was reading in Revelation chapter 11 verse 15 this morning. In Revelation chapter 11 verse 15, it's very, very interesting. It said, you know, the seventh angel sounded. In Revelation chapter 11 verse 15, and when the seventh angel sounded, and there were great voices from heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and it shall reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. That's the end of the story. That's the end, period. That's the end of the story. All these battles in the middle are just a passing phase of the trouble. But that's exactly what it is. That was the time I was reading to us again in Daniel chapter 2. I believe in verse 43 and verse 44 in Daniel. The book of Daniel chapter 2. As to tell us that these things we are talking about is not guesswork. It is something that we learn. That as the enemies were routed here, that is how God will rout his enemies. And listen, as we live and as we continue, we don't know what we shall yet face. Some antichrist may arise. All right? Some real antichrist may get up. I was telling my wife about one yesterday, which I don't want to talk about here. But they may arise. And we don't know where they are living, where they're hiding. But no matter, at the end of the day, we win the battle. Hallelujah. Because in chapter 2 of Daniel, it says in chapter 2, verse 44. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people. In other words, God himself will be the ruler of that kingdom. But it shall break in pieces and consume all these other kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. For as much as thou sawest the stone that was cut out of the mountain with our hands, and that it break in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, the gold, the great God had made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter, and the dream is certain and the interpretation sure. Praise God. The dream is certain and the interpretation sure. In other words, that's what is going to happen. I'm just wondering if you're on the side of the devil. I'm just wondering if you are playing church. I'm just wondering if when you are in the church, you are still representing darkness. I'm just wondering if you are going by the name of Joseph, and you are going by the name of Theophilus, and you are going by any name Daniel, and you are going by any name, and you are serving the devil, because of eventually your generation and your type will be wiped out of the face of the earth, no matter your power. And so it is very clear from the scriptures that the victory of Daniel is our victory. The victory of Joshua is our victory. The victory of these people in the Bible is our victory. And so we know that definitely that's where God wants us to put our hearts. That the victory of these people are not just for themselves, but to encourage us. So that we ourselves, we will have our own victories in the things in our time that grace can conquer in the name of Jesus Christ. In verse 6, it says, then did Moses, the servant of the Lord, and the children of Israel smite, and Moses, the servant of the Lord, gave it for a possession unto the Reubenites and the Gadites and the half-tribe Manasseh. So these eastern lands for Reuben, for Gad, and for half-tribe Manasseh were given to them by Moses. And actually, they settled there, but it was not a good decision. I just want to remark that Moses allowed them to stay there, but that was not the final destination that God told them to go. God told them to go to Canaan land. That's the possession. But they decided the other place was an agricultural land, so they are going to stay there. Listen, when the captivity began, these Gadites and these Reubenites and the half tribe Manasseh were the first to go into captivity, and they never returned. Their tribes were wiped out. They were the first to go into captivity. The first captivity. Okay? Not the Babylonian captivity. Okay? Because there were two captivities. There is the Babylonian captivity. There is the captivity that happened to the northern kingdom. And so, these two and a half tribes, they were the first to be captured and led into captivity. And so, when God says, go and settle in A, don't go and settle in B, because you don't know what will happen in B tomorrow. And God that has the knowledge is the one that will decide what happens on that side. So may God grant us grace and wisdom in our dealing with him in the name of Jesus Christ. And then we are told in verse 7 and 8 that these are the kings of the country that Joshua and the children of Israel smote on the side on the side Jordan on the west. We are told and we have read those things. But number B, under number B, I want to read the A there. These are the kings of the country which Joshua and the children of Israel conquered on the side of Jordan. Again, this only seems tedious to us because it is not our land. If it were our land, we will read it each line with great interest. I used to remember when Pa Elton from Elisha was alive. He used to say that when he returns in the second coming with Christ, that part of Yoruba land, he will lay a claim to it. Praise God. Because this was where he labored and died. This was where he raised disciples and died. And so he said, part of Yoruba land, especially Elisha, that he will be part of the company that will come back to Elisha. And it's true. It's very right. And so today, where you labor, God recognizes that place. And it is good to pray, to know where to labor, and not to labor in the wrong place. Because when you labor in the wrong place, the credit belongs to somebody else. It's a waste of time. So a specific recounting of the 31 kings that Joshua conquered are very interesting, as we have read them before. And we're told the king of Jericho won. Somebody asked me, he said, why is it they're saying the king of Jericho won? The king of Ai won. But you will see in the reading that there were some territories that were governed by one king. But the name of the places were mentioned together. But then they say it is under one ruler. Okay? It's under one ruler. Because Ibadan has suburbs. Lagos has suburbs. All right? Kano has suburbs. And so when Kano is defeated, then we say it is, so you understand what I'm talking about. So the king of Jericho, these were descriptions also important because they make it clear that these things happen in real time and in real space. These are not fairy tales that begin with once upon a time. This is history that begins with specific places and specific people and specific rulers. And outside of the Bible, the stories and the history are kept of these victories of Joshua. So sometimes in the course of our human experience, it is good to sit down and reflect what has been conquered by the grace of God through our lives. And that is very, very important because at the end of time, you see, we will be asked, what did we do with the grace that we had? Now, let's pay attention to that for a few more minutes before we close. What can grace conquer? We've read about Joshua now, but how about us? Let's apply the lesson to ourselves. Let's apply the lessons that we learn from the scriptures. Let's apply and see in the New Testament what it is to us. Because I told us at the beginning that these things we are reading is a challenge. In other words, it stirs up our heart and we see it as, look at what God used this man to do. Look at what the grace of God did in the life of this person and that person. That is why it is very important that first of all, we are able to conquer sin. All right? That grace is able to conquer sin in our life. That grace is able to bring us sanctification. That grace is able to overthrow all the circumstances of our relatives and people and other people in our lives that have traversed our lives. And we are able to say clearly that God is our God. And I'm praying that that will be made possible in the mighty name of Jesus. I want to remind you that God is interested that we win our battles. That God is interested that we win our battles. Not only win our battles, but that the grace to win our battles are available. And we shall use it in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Number one, the grace of God is also the power of God. Okay? The grace of God is also the power of God. Number two, the grace of God is also the ability of God operating through human beings so we can effectively walk in whatever area, into whatever will He is calling us, or whatever He is calling us to do in this life. It is the grace of God that is His power to be able to do that. Number two, it is His ability in us, operating in us, to effectively begin to carry out those things. So it is the grace of God, number three, that can conquer sin, that can conquer rebellion, that can conquer addictions, that can conquer temptations, that can conquer lying, that can conquer pretending, pretending to somebody who you are not, pretending to have a double face. You know, you pretend so much that you have a double name and you have a double face, all right? And you are doing that because grace is not available in your life. So first, the grace of God is the power of God to do His will on the earth. Number two, it is the ability that God puts in us to be able to operate through us so that we can effectively walk in whatever area He will be calling us, or He has called us to do something for Him in this life. To do something for Him, not for ourselves only in this life. You know, a lot of people pray, but what people should pray about is that their destiny will be fulfilled. That what God has given birth to them for will happen. And I pray for everyone listening right now that that shall be your portion in the name of Jesus Christ. Number four, we see this grace in Joshua and what he was called to do for him. We see this grace in Joshua and what he was called by God to do. And we see that some of the things that Joshua did are supernatural. They are beyond human. They are beyond what man can guess. They are beyond what man can do. And so God must be involved. Praise God. God must be involved. That's why I've been talking of late that we have the Holy Spirit. But listen to me. I find in all of the Bible in beings to help them. A singer, for instance, like Don Moen. Every time he's singing, people follow him around to tell him that there are angels singing with you. And that's why your music is able to go throughout the world. Because those messages were not coined by his brain and by his ability to sing. Okay, so as he sings, the angels come to breathe on what he's saying, as what he's singing, to give him a tune, to give him the language of heaven. So it's important. So we see that we'll never be able to reach the goal and finish line of our destinies if God does not help us. And so it's important. Now, many unbelievers become crooked in their quest to reach the top and go to hell for it. On the other side, many believers, also still in the flesh, do not rely on God's power to get to the place they are supposed to be going with God. That's the sad part of it. They don't seem to rely on God. So let's look at some scriptures, like I said, as quickly as we can, to measure and correlate it with the book of Joshua. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 33. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse 33. These are not on your outline. And sometimes I do so deliberately, because just getting the outline is not enough. In Acts of the Apostles, chapter 4, verse number 33. And with great power, Greg gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. So I want you to notice the putting side by side the phrase great power and great grace. Great power and great grace. That's what the scripture says there. With great power gave the apostles witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Bible said, great grace was upon them all. Hallelujah. So you see that the grace of God and the power of God are things that you can exchange in terms of talking. Because they are told them, ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. So you can see that in 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18. It says, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord. Grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. So you see, we are to grow in that grace. We can grow in that power. That's why I was telling us the other day that the Pentecostals have removed prophecy from baptism of the Holy Spirit. All right? The Bible said they were filled with the Holy Ghost and they spoke in tongues and prophesied. Today people speak in tongues, but they cannot prophesy. So what's the problem? That means they have not prayed to the point that they will be able to pray and prophesy. Because these are gifts of power. These are gifts of revelation. These are gifts to know what the devil is doing. When you are praying for somebody and you want to see, you want to know what is the root cause of the person's palaver. You want to know what is the root cause of the person's problem. And so you pray and you tell the person, well, can you excuse me? I want to pray in tongues. And then you begin to pray in tongues. And as you are praying in tongues, you give the interpretation of what you are praying in tongues. And you are able to tell the person this accurately what is wrong with the person. Praise God. And this is power. This is power. When you can see beyond the individual. When you can see beyond the person. Alright? When you can see beyond what is wrong with the individual. Physically. And you can see into the hand that we can grow in grace. We can grow in this power. And this is what brethren have not taken cognizance of. We have not taken it seriously to grow in the power of God. To grow in the grace of God. We've just scratched the surface. Most of us have just scratched the surface. And then we are satisfied. Oh, that something has happened to us. No, we shouldn't be satisfied so easily. But rather, we should be going further and further and further and further. And let the power of God increase in our lives. In 2 Timothy, reading in chapter 2, verse 1. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I want to read here. It says, thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. In other words, we have to learn how to be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. My son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. In other words, when you have tasted grace, you want to make it stronger. You don't want the grace you have last year to reduce. You don't want the grace you have before to go lower. All right? And say somebody has fasted maybe 5 days or 10 days or 15 days, or no matter how many. And then he then goes back to his old way of eating and drinking. And then he slides back and he's heavier than he used to be, you know. And that kind of thing, you see that people retrogress because they have no awareness of spiritual things. And they are not learned in spiritual things. And as a result, they lose ground. And they lose ground, they have to recover again. And so it becomes a ding-dong matter, up and down like the children of Israel. So we can lose the grace of God that way. But Paul tells Timothy to learn how to be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 8. It gives us more additional meat to meditate upon. In 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse number 8, he said, "And God is able to make all grace abound toward you, and that ye always having all sufficiency in all things may abound to every good work." So, we are told here that we can abound in every good work. That grace can abound. What's the meaning of abound? Because sometimes we read King James and we read English, but we actually do not know the meaning of those words. What's the meaning of abound? Abound means to increase greatly. That's the meaning of abound, to increase greatly. Praise God. Are you with me? I always tell people, I said, well, you can't accuse me of going into missions. I said, that's the plan of God for my life. All right? I said, I started in a village somewhere. And I graduated to the city somewhere. And I graduated to the nation somewhere. And I graduated to nations somewhere. And then God now said, okay, go and preach to all nations. As many places as you can get to, and you'll be accepted. I mean, that's what led to why we're standing here today. And that's no gainsaying. It is just to say that, you know, when people are thinking, they don't think about the fact of where are you coming from? Or where are you coming from and where you are going? And they have no respect for it. Maybe because, you know, you talk to everybody, everybody is happy, but nobody wants to go after what some brethren have gone after and say, well, this person has gone this way. If God can do for him and he can abound, I also, God can help me in a little way while I'm alive to abound. And so to abound means to increase greatly. And so that's exactly what he's saying there. To increase greatly, he wants to give us this grace. And this great abundance, that's what he's talking about. And so he said, God is able to make all grace abound towards you, right? So that always having all sufficiency, okay, you become, all right, because grace made available to you the grace, so you have sufficient, all right? You have sufficient to be able to abound in all things, all right? In all good works, praise the Lord. In all good works. In all good works. That's why we have to continue to pray. That's how we have to look for every model to pray. Okay? To pray. I was telling my brethren the other day, I said, there was a man that went to a man of God and he said, "Sir, I want to do business." And the man said, "Well, what do you want?" He said, "Well, I just want to pray for me." He said, "What level of business do you want to do? Because you see the work I'm doing here, if God blesses you, he'll also bless the ministry. He'll also bless the work of God. I'm not talking of blessing me particularly." He said, "But if you do this thing seriously, you know, that's what can result." And so they kept him in the place and they fasted and prayed with him for 7 days. I mean, like Balaam, they moved him to another location. They fasted and prayed with him for another 7 days. And then they moved him to another location, fasted and prayed with him for another 7 days. And then he went into his business. And in 5 months, this man was rubbing shoulders in all the 4 major oil companies in Nigeria. He got contracts from all the 4 major companies. And not only that, after about 1.5 years, I was told that this man had four ships, ocean-going vessels, and on like that. But he soon forgot where he started. He soon forgot that it was prayer that gave birth to all that he was doing. So the man of God that prayed for him followed him to Abuja and said, let me go and talk to him. So he got there. Oh, they say he cannot see the managing director. And he said they should give him an hotel room. So they gave him a hotel room. And he stayed there for 3 days. Are you with me? They stayed there for 3 days, waiting to see the managing director he prayed for. And after 3 days, he didn't come out. He didn't see him. So he was carrying women all over the place, chartering aeroplane from Port Harcourt to Abuja, from Abuja to Lagos, just spending money. And then the man of God went away. Second time he looked for him, it was impossible. Third time he looked for him. So the man of God went to pray. And God told him, the angel that I gave him for this breakthrough, I'm going to remove the angel. And I will send the angel to his junior brother. And his junior brother will be doing this same business, and he will not have mercy on him. And so, after a very little time, the man ran into debt. His ocean-going vessel sank in the Atlantic. Everything perished. Everything perished. He became a debtor, a write-off, and his brother picked up and didn't have mercy on him because he had wasted his substance. I'm talking about power. I'm talking about grace making being abundant to people. Praise God. I'm talking about grace being abundant to people. I don't want to mention other cases probably that you know. There are issues that I've shared. There are people I've brought to this pulpit to share with us, you know, how do they receive resources that they receive, you know. Some of them came and spoke into the wind and went away. Nobody said, if this woman is talking about like this, can I do a little, you know. Some people just listen and then that's the end. When the time is gone, that's the end of the message. And the message has finished, you know. And there is no pursuing. All right? There is no pursuing. I was challenging some people the other day. I said, what's wrong if you set a high timetable, a high level for yourself? Praise God. And sometimes we start and then the thing gets aborted. You know, you repent and prepare again because you want this grace in your life to abound. But we are not consistent in the way we do it. And as a result, we cannot have grace conquering and conquering and conquering over and over and over again. It is this exhortation that I will exhort you, that you take note of and all of us take note of. In Romans chapter 12 verse 6, Romans chapter 12 verse number 6, Romans chapter 12 verse number 6, Romans chapter 12 verse number 6. It says this, Romans 12:6. It said, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith, or ministry, let us wait on our ministering. And he that teacheth on teaching, and he that is with cheerfulness. You know, so you can see these things. When mercy, all right, when hallelujah, when rulership really comes on a man, when it has arrived, and the Lord is with you, of course, there may be a lot of issues, a lot of problems, but you definitely would overcome those issues and problems. He said in verse number 7, he said on ministry, let him wait on ministering. And now he buys in and ties in the grace with the gifts. Because gifts themselves in the Greek language is charisma. The multiple gifts is charismata. All right, that's the plural for charisma. Charisma is singular. Charismata is plural. And so when somebody has one or two gifts, that means there is the display of the grace of God in his life that there's some charismatic gifts that God has given him, the gifts of grace that God has given for him to share with the world. So here he ties in the gift. After talking about grace for a long time, now he gets here in Romans chapter 12 and ties in the gift and says the gift is part of the grace that we have. In 1 Peter chapter 4, reading in verse 10. 1 Peter, this is one of my best passages in the New Testament. In verse 9, use hospitality one to another without grudging. And then verse 10, as every man had received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Good stewards of the manifold grace of God. And then verse 11 says, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracle of God. If any man minister, let him do it with ability that God giveth. And God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. So he says, when you have gift, minister it according to the grace and ability that God gives. Not according to my own ability. Not according to my own ability. There is no humility in this. Nobody can tell me that, you know, you see somebody dying and you have the gift of healing and you won't pray for the person dying. I mean, they say, well, maybe they say I'm proud. I mean, what's pride there? Somebody is sick. What's your own? Just pray for the sick and leave the place. You are not told to take the glory. You are not being queried why the man was not healed or the woman was not healed. That's not the issue. But it is a misunderstanding. It's a misjudgment. It's a bad judgment on our part and a misinterpretation of the scriptures. Rejoice that you got anything. Lose grip of this power that you got from God. And he listened. Because from time to time he calls me and he tells me supernatural things that no man can even talk about. And so it's important for you and I to buy into the grace of God, to tie into the gift of the Spirit, as we are told in this particular passage. I like to read the last passage because I have like 8 passages. I've read 7. Let me read the 8th one and then we close. In Ephesians chapter 4. Reading in verse 7, Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, reading in verse 7. Ephesians chapter 4, in verse 7. It says, but unto every one of us in grace, according to the measure of the gift of Christ. In other words, if you're a child of God, you have some gifts. The ability to dig it out is what the elders help you to do. The ability to drag the thing out, dig it out, so that you don't labor too much. You know, there are people who have gifts, but then they are sleeping on their gifts. Okay. They are dozing on their gifts. And the thing is not working because they are sleeping. Okay, they are not waking up. Praise God. They are not waking up. Praise the Lord. I don't know whether if it has ever happened to you that you feel, oh God, give me this thing. And you left your bed physically and you are sleeping on the floor. Real hard concrete, and you are sleeping on concrete, and say, God, except you do this thing for me, I will not let you go. And you deny yourself. You say, well, the palace Christians will tell you that God is not difficult like that. God is not hard like that. Just by grace. By grace. Yeah, it's by grace. Nobody says it's by law. Nobody says it's by works. Nobody has ever said that. But the flesh must die to receive and not be confident in itself that it manufactured the grace of God. Praise God. I say praise God. So a lot of things we still need to learn about seeking God and finding him. And I pray that what we have had tonight will not just be a drop in the bucket or something that we fold and put in our Bibles and then go away, leave our house and feel that, we have heard the word of God, praise God, and then that word of God was so powerful today. No, that's not why I'm here. Why I'm here is to tell you that there is something behind something. Now, what I'm here to tell you is that there is something behind something, all right? there is the power of God behind the grace that we receive. There is the power of God behind everything that we see physically and everywhere in our lives. And so I want us to take some time now to go to the Lord in prayer and begin to pray for God to help us, to God to help us to aggregate this knowledge that we have, this plentiful knowledge that we have, to aggregate it with grace, to aggregate it with prayer, that prayer will make it function. That it will not be something we are telling somebody. It will be something that we are able to demonstrate. And something that is able to work on our behalf. Yesterday, somebody called me. I remember, sometime last year, somebody came here from Port Harcourt. And then, just came with his wife. I never met him before. And he came from, my friend's church. And he came and he said, I've been going to the hospital several places in Nigeria, in Australia. They have been testing my wife for this heart problem, and they have spent millions. And so he says, sir, that's why I have come to see you, so that you can pray for my wife, and my wife will be healed. I said, no problem. Let's go to the room there. And we sat in the room there, and I prayed for this woman and prayed for the husband as well. And then yesterday, the brother that sent them to me called me and said, sir, do you know something? The woman is back in Australia and they have run every test possible and they cannot find any trace of any disease. That she is made whole. She's made whole. Now, you can imagine, I heard that yesterday. That makes me glad. That makes me happy. Happy not for myself, but the fact that somebody was dying. Somebody was needed help, and he needed prayer, and he believed God, and traveled from Port Harcourt to this place, very desperate. He is not saying, is it not this brother Lamont? He is not saying that, oh, this is this brother that is speaking to us all the time. That my friend. That once relationship, when it comes with spiritual things, boiled down to this is my friend, you have lost the contact. Nothing that the person says can work for you. That's how they talk to Jesus. They say, is he not the carpenter's son who is from our backyard here? So then he's doing these things. Leave him, Jerry. And that was why they berated the person. But I'm saying this night that any devil that is laughing at your grace, let them face this grace in the name of Jesus. Shall we rise up and pray? Can we rise up and pray to the Lord that every mockery, every person mocking your grace, let them be disgraced in the name of Jesus. Any power that is mocking your grace, they will not be able to go scot-free in the mighty, mighty, mighty name of Jesus Christ. I want us to pray about that. First of all, let's repent from all our iniquities. Let's repent from all our sins. Let's repent from everything that hinders us, because grace can conquer sin. Grace can conquer stubbornness. Grace can conquer anything that is conquerable in the realm of sin, because Jesus died. Jesus was buried, and Jesus rose again from the dead. That resurrection life is able to make us to overcome sin. It's able to make us overcome the devil. It's able to make us overcome all the challenges of life. That's why we're in a nation like this, that we may be able to pray for every man and every leader and everyone, because the grace of God is with us. So, let the mercy of God speak through us in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus. I want you to pray for yourself and ask God to help you particularly. Wherever you may be listening to me right now, I know that some of you are listening somewhere, and I want to encourage you to seek God. Just like Joshua was able to conquer and conquer and conquer and conquer and go on conquering, until he became an old man. He went conquering and conquering, 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 and just giving victory. Was given victory by God. So let the power of God be able to follow you in the name of Jesus. Can you say with me, Father, in the name of Jesus, let the fire of revival fall upon FMI in the name of Jesus. Let's pray that the fire of revival will fall upon us. The fire of revival will fall upon every family. The fire of revival will fall upon every house. Will fall upon every man. Will fall upon every woman. It will fall upon everyone in the name of Jesus Christ. Just say, oh God, arise. Let the fire of revival fall in FMI. Oh God, arise. Let the fire of revival fall over FMI. Oh God, arise. Let the fire of revival fall over FMI more than ever before, more than whatever we have seen, more than whatever we have known. Oh God, arise. Let the fire of God fall upon FMI in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we prayed. Can we pray and say, Father, arise, O God. Give us wings like eagles that we may fly into the realm of the Spirit, in the name of Jesus. Let us mount with wings as eagles. That's the way the Bible puts it, that we will mount with wings as eagles, in the name of Jesus. Can you say, oh God, grant unto me to be able to mount with wings as eagles, in the name of Jesus. Help me, Father. Redoprakide masolaka. A broke band that be the hallelujah. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we prayed. Can we pray and say, Father, wherever we have offended you, in any area we have offended you, and we don't even know that we have offended, Father, forgive in the name of Jesus. If there are things we need to do and we didn't do, if there are steps we need to take and we didn't take it, if there are preparations we need to prepare and we neglected, if there are times we need to spend with you and we omitted, if there are places we need to go and pray and we refused to pray, if we needed to do something with our time and we failed you, Father, in the name of Jesus, we plead for mercy and plead for forgiveness in the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, forgive us for making you angry because of this. Oh Lord, forgive us for making you angry, and we repent of these iniquities and this time-wasting things in the name of Jesus. We repent from all our iniquities, oh Lord, in the name that is above every name, and we ask for your mercy. We ask for your mercy. Let your mercy speak. Let your mercy speak. Let your mercy speak. Have mercy upon us as a nation. Have mercy upon us as a church. Have mercy upon us as a state. Have mercy upon us as a group of people. Have mercy upon our families. Have mercy upon those that are listening to us right now. We pray that you sanitize the air, that we breathe with the blood of Jesus. We ask in the mighty, mighty name of Jesus that you would do this in the name of Jesus. Send your power, O God. Send your power, O Lord, and save our land from destruction and judgment in the name of Jesus. Redombra tonda fasa. Let's send your healing power. Send your healing power and begin to operate in our land. Send your healing power. Let your healing power begin to operate from the north to the south, from the south to the north, from the east to the west, from the west to the east, from the center to the circumference. In the name of Jesus, we bind and cast out every dragon. Babandera baboba solekata masa. I broke a bandala babu de halabarata. I broke a panto santa karabahaya. As GM nambodika la panda halatuja. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we prayed. Father, can you say with me, Father? Endow us with your power. Endow me with your power until I see it in the manifestation. Until I see it working in my face. Lord, endow me with your power. 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 In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we prayed. Shall we say, Father, every wicked spirit assigned to terminate our life, be expired in the name of Jesus. Expire in the name of Jesus. Let thunder from God scatter them, Father. Scatter them, Lord. Scatter them, Father. Scatter them, Lord. Break into pieces every dark gathering against your life. In the mighty name of Jesus, ye broke a bandala bari hende pansa, a roca panta labra tonda paso lakaya, a broke a bandala babode, hallelujah. Every evil weapon formed against you in existence, let them catch fire, let them catch fire, let them catch fire. Every weapon assigned against you, let them catch fire, let them catch fire, let them catch fire, let them catch fire, let them catch fire. While you sleep, let them catch fire. Where you wake up, let them catch fire. Let his angels go before you. Let his angels come after you. Let his angels surround you. In the name of Jesus. Rande posole canta. A broke a bandala babudi, hallelujah. Ye denta paso leke namarata. A broke a bandala babudi, hallelujah. Ye diso taka mando habaraka. A broke a bandala babida, hallelujah. We shall break forth with joy. 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 In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Now, I want you to take your Bible. This is the final request I'm going to make. And those of you that are listening to us, I just want to encourage you, whatever challenge you are having, the power of God is working right now, and you are delivered in the mighty name of Jesus. Now, in Psalm 91, reading in verse 9 and 10, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High God, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall you, neither shall any plague come nigh your dwelling. I didn't hear your amen. Your amen is too cold. Can I hear another amen? Can you all read verse 11 together? For he shall give his angels charge over you, to keep you in what way? In all your ways. The Lord will keep you. The Lord will not forsake you. The Lord will not forsake your family. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we bless this time in the mighty name of Jesus. And we rebuke.